Hey everybody, what's up? I'm DJ Sixsmith. Welcome to the Sit Down. David Michaelis here with us. Brand new book, Eleanor, all about our former First Lady, and she was so much more than that, Eleanor Roosevelt. David, how are you?
Thanks, DJ. Great. Thanks for having me today.
So you have a pretty interesting personal story when it comes to Eleanor Roosevelt. As a young four-year-old, you got to meet her, and there's a family connection there. So can you give that story for everybody? And you know, what was it like writing this book?
My mom was a producer, television producer in the very early days of national educational television, even before Julia Child and The French Chef. This very tall, very white-haired, extraordinarily globe-trotting Eleanor Roosevelt, the Eleanor Roosevelt of, you know, her last great days, was the monthly host of a public television program that had on, you know, young Senator Kennedy or young Zbigniew Brzezinski or, you know, young Henry Kissinger. And my mother's job was as producer. And one day I got to go to the studio and crawling around on the cables and, you know, on the stage, I guess I just must have thought this lady had everything and she must have, therefore, a stick of chewing gum also. And I asked her, you know, I said sort of nervously when she kind of bent down to look at me, kind of like, was it you want? Because everybody wanted something from Eleanor Roosevelt, and I was no different. So anyway, I think I said something like, you know, juicy fruit. And she was fresh out of juicy fruit and was very amused that I would think she had some. But I had this feeling, and I remember it very clearly. It's the main part of this memory, really, which is of goodness, you know, of a human being from whose inner life, from whom, literally from inside her eyes, came this kind of feeling of goodness, of wanting to help, of wanting to be available, not to the son of her producer, but it was so clearly the Eleanor that I later encountered when I began to understand what her life was about. And I also, strangely enough, encountered it in her columns when I found them in the syndicate basement on Madison Avenue, where I was researching the life of Charles Schulz in the beginning of Peanuts and Charlie Brown and Snoopy. And there was Schulz S, and there was R, Roosevelt, just to the left of those boxes in the basement. And I lifted the lid and I thought, wow, Eleanor Roosevelt wrote a column. And the first thing I saw was this description of starlight that I found really quite beautiful and compelling and very different than the way I thought she wrote about things in that column. And it was another one of those moments of thinking, wow, there's something here. And I felt strongly as I began the book that I wanted to convey to people not the Eleanor they thought they knew. We all sort of think we know who she is, but the Eleanor of who she was in the context of her life. And the trouble with most biographies of figures like Eleanor, if they're stretched over three volumes, I mean, there's a great Eleanor Roosevelt biography that's three volumes long. There are really strong biographies of, obviously, of Franklin Roosevelt, of her husband, that do a very strong job with her. I felt like what we are missing as a culture was to understand Eleanor whole, you know, to see her life whole and to see how she made the great transformations and leaps that we know she made, but how did she do it? How did she go from being a Edith Wharton era aristocratic child, orphaned by her parents and their really tragic, awful deaths? Her mother died of diphtheria at the moment she was going to become a society lady leader, her father, a alcoholic and junkie, genuinely at the time, addicted to opium and laudanum, he died a tragic death. And in between those two deaths, her oldest younger brother, she had two younger brothers, and the older of the two died. So in 19 months, her entire family, with the exception of herself and her youngest brother, whom she became a kind of surrogate mother to, were orphaned, and they went to live with their grandmother. That began this saga for Eleanor of how to get on with who she thought she would be, but being held back again and again and again for the next 15 or 20 years, really. So Eleanor Roosevelt's life almost doesn't even begin to 35 or 40, and then it's just crammed with, I mean, there's so much in Eleanor Roosevelt's life, from even the First World War, the Second World War, the Depression in between, and then the whole post-war era, that to see it whole, I figured would give you a better context of who she really was if you saw her in each of those transformations.
Well, I'm glad it's all in one book. I think that benefits us as readers here. And you mentioned something really interesting, is that people always wanted something from Eleanor Roosevelt, but she was also trying to figure out who she was. How did she balance that? And when did you realize that was one of the major themes in her life?
Well, you know, it's funny. I had a real struggle with this book because the men that I'd written about before had fairly simple lives by comparison. They, like most men's lives, they kind of, went to a big success and then sort of receded from that success. It was Charles Schulz and the painter N.C. Wyeth. Both had great big successes in the middle of their life, and then they kind of receded from this. Eleanor just kept opening up and up, and as her life kept opening outward, so did the things that she cared about and was trying very hard to make changes in and be useful to, causes, civil rights, human rights, so many causes. But I kept thinking in my writing that I would somehow be able to resolve these, that she would have resolved them, that her own life would somehow resolve the questions that were raised in each of these areas. And it really didn't. And it was only when I finally realized that it was simply by getting up every day and continuing to try and continuing to put her shoulder to the wheel that she made sense of her own life. She really wasn't trying to resolve things. And that was sort of the trick for me finally of allowing myself to wrap it up in one book rather than this endless sense of, oh, there's more to tell. Actually, there always is with Eleanor. There's a million documents in her papers at Hyde Park. You could fashion a dozen different biographies of her at any different time, just focusing on one or another of the things that consumed her. But I think for her, it was she spoke very candidly to people about doing one thing every day that you're afraid to do. Do one thing that scares you. Do the thing you think you cannot do was one of her great messages. And one of the things that she said about how you do the thing you think you cannot do is by having done it before. In other words, every time you think you can't do something, if you do it and try to do it, you'll find greater strength the next time you're faced with the same challenge. And I think that's really what she did. She just simply kept accruing and building and developing a strength and a hopeful, positive, fairly positive, even though she did have a very realistic outlook on the world. She kept saying, keep trying, keep doing, and you will arrive at some point that will surprise you about where you're going.